So, I'll speak on the Bhagavad Gita, chapter 4, text 10. Krishna says over there that Vita Raga Bhaya Krodha Manmaya Mama Pashataha Bahavo Jnana Tapasa Putamad Bhavamagataha. That by practicing this process, Bahavo Jnana Tapasa, many people in the past have become purified. And mad bhavam agataha, they have attained love for me. So in the previous verses in the 64th chapter, Krishna has talked about how he descends to this world to establish dharma. And whenever there is a upsurgence of adharma, he himself personally sets it right. And when he is not there, he has created a system by which there are the Raj Rishis, the saintly kings who share spiritual knowledge. So I will speak on the theme of how the bhakti tradition is a garden, not a museum. The living bhakti tradition is a garden, not a museum. I'll talk this in three parts. First is, now what do we mean by the living bhakti tradition? And then what is the understanding of the bhakti tradition as a museum? And then what is the understanding of bhakti tradition as a garden? When we live each moment at the junction or the intersection of the past and the future. The present is, it's present at one moment and it's gone the next moment. So the present is all that we experience. We don't experience the past first hand. We experience the past as a memory. And we experience the future as a possibility. The present is the only reality for us. But the present is constantly changing. And even in, say, fields like science, I think it is Newton several hundred years ago, he said that, and even Einstein said something similar, that if I have seen more than others, it is because I am standing on the shoulders of giants. So the idea is that even in a field like science, which prides itself on progress and innovation and development, there also nobody starts from the beginning. As they say, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. So we all build on the knowledge that we have previously. And that's how we move forwards in life. Now, if you look at the history of the world, curiously, especially with the start of the modern times, so which started more or less the age of science in the 17th, 18th century onwards. From that time onwards, the view of the past changed. In general, before the advent of the modern times, people treated the past with reverence. That whether it is India or whether it is the Middle East, where the Abrahamic religions emerged, or whether it is the Native American traditions, everywhere people treated the past with a sense of respect. That, oh, there were great thinkers, there were wise seers in the past, and we learn from them. But with the advent of science, things changed to a significant degree, and people started thinking that the past is very primitive. Oh, there were the dark ages in the past, people were unscientific, people were superstitious, people were irrational. And that's why in the narrative of mainstream history, in fact, they refer to this period when science started gaining a sway on people's mind. They call it as the Enlightenment. So generally we use the word enlightenment in the spiritual sense, but they use it enlightenment that's when we awakened and we started learning about science. So the attitude towards the past is that, oh, it's primitive and we are really going to get knowledge. But in a sense, even in science now, science also has created its own tradition where scientists are very proud of, say, pioneering scientists, say Newton or Darwin is also considered an icon. So anything which is even a rebellion against tradition soon becomes a tradition itself. So science started off as a rebellion against what was considered traditional knowledge, it's considered unscientific. But science created its own tradition. So tradition essentially means that we learn knowledge from the past and then we utilize that knowledge in our life. So about 50 years ago, Martin Luther King put his finger very eloquently on the predicament of today's world. He said that our scientific power has outrun our spiritual power. And we have guided missiles and misguided men. So we have guided missiles and misguided men. It means that actually through technology, we have learned a lot about how to control the outer world. Today, if it's a storm is going to come, we can know days or weeks in advance and we can evacuate. If it's going to be cold or hot, we can adjust our day, adjust our heating and cooling. So we have gained a significant amount of control over the external world. But simultaneously, we seem to have lost a lot of control over the inner world. Inner world means our own emotions, our own mind. And that's why mental health problems are among the biggest health challenges in the current world. Now, in some cases, mental health problems can have clinical causes where they need medical treatment specifically. But in many cases, the mental health problems are because we have, because we're just not able to manage our minds. The ultimate expression of the mind becoming our enemy is when someone commits suicide. The mind literally kills the body. So, what is this mind? And now, in psychology, there's a mainstream psychologist who refused, who said, I will not study the mind because the mind has no locus standi. There is no place where you can locate the mind. Okay, this is the heart, these are the lungs, this is this. Where is the mind? So, in fact, there's a reductionistic approach in psychology. We say psychology is not the study of the mind. Psyche means the mind, logos is study. But they redefined it as psychology is a study of behavior. Because you don't know what is the mind, so just focus on behavior. So, even though science itself cannot tangibly place the mind, but the mind affects all of us. And the yoga texts, the Bhagavad Gita, the Bhagavatam, they give us a holistic understanding of the self. The self is a three-level being, body, mind and soul. And this we can compare to a software, computer system. The hardware, the software and the user. The hardware is the body, the software is the mind and the soul is the user. So, if we have the best hardware for our computer, but if the software is corrupted by viruses, the computer will become useless. So, in scientific, in the scientific driven world or technology driven world, we are focusing a lot on improving the hardware, but we have neglected the software and we have neglected the user. So, thus we have people who are young, healthy, good looking and still they are depressed, they are suicidal. So, the software has become corrupted. And the bhakti tradition helps us to understand how to clean the software inside us, how to purify ourselves. And it explains that ultimately, whatever it is that we are longing for love. Even when people want wealth, people want good looks, people want degrees, it's all so that they hope they will get love. And love is not just an abstract conception. Love comes from a source. So we long for a loving and lovable object to relate with. And that supreme person, that the Bhagavad Bhakti tradition explains that there is an all-attractive supreme person. That all-attractive supreme person is Krishna. So Krishna is not just the name of a sectarian god, he is Sarva Akarshati Iti Krishna, one who attracts everyone. So the bhakti tradition is a tradition of love. That is a tradition of those who have loved Krishna and those who have taught others to love Krishna. So what happens, our mind, it thinks this will give me pleasure, that will give me pleasure, that will give me pleasure. Nowadays, people search for pleasure on the internet. I just read an article yesterday. Said on average, Americans spend about 10.5 hours consuming media every day. Whether it is phones or TVs or computers, on average 10.5 hours. Now, we may be working also, but we don't know what exactly they are doing. But consuming media is not really referring to work per se. It's something other than work. But it's so people are surfing. So now, whatever specifically we may be surfing for, we are actually surfing for Krishna. Krishna is the all-attractive Supreme Person. And we are looking for love, we are looking for beauty, we are looking for happiness. And that comes by connecting with Krishna. Actually, many people are surfing on the net and many people are suffering on the net. there is digital internet addiction is there. There is video game addiction. There is so many TV addiction. So there is so much which people get caught by afterwards. So we are looking for Krishna. Our heart will be satisfied only when we can connect with Krishna. And this is not a tradition, this is not an insight unique to the bhakti tradition. Even in the Christian tradition, St. Augustine said that we are made for God and our heart will not find peace, will not find rest till it rests in God. So the idea that we are meant to devote ourselves to God is there in all theistic traditions in the world. The bhakti tradition offers us something special in the sense that it reveals God in far greater detail and attractiveness. Who is God? As a supremely loving and lovable person, that revelation comes in the bhakti tradition. So, we just did the Damodar Arati. It's Krishna as God. He's a small child who eats butter and steals butter and runs away. When the European colonialists came to India in the 17th, 18th centuries, and they came to North India and they saw these wall paintings, murals with this picture of this small baby boy with butter on his face. They asked, who is this? And they got the answer, it's God. God. They had the idea of God, the stern being sitting in the clouds, sending thunderbolts down on the sinful. It's God. What is he doing? He says, he's stealing butter. What? Why does God have to steal? And even if he has to steal, why butter of all things? So, they got, you could say, intellectually short-circuited. Just couldn't make sense of anything. But Krishna doesn't need to steal butter. See, Krishna is the supreme being. But as God, he doesn't delight in his godhood. He delights in reciprocating love. And for reciprocating love, the infinite can take a finite form. And he can take just the form of a small child so that he can reciprocate love with those who want to love him as a mother. And he doesn't need to steal anything, everything belongs to him. But stealing is an act of mischief by which he increases the love his mother has for him and the love his mother has he has for his mother. He intensifies the devotion. And why butter? Butter represents the heart of the devotees. That Mother Yashoda and other gopis, they work hard, they diligently, they churn the butter so that they can offer it to Krishna. And Vishnu comes and steals the butter, it's like he's coming and stealing their hearts. So Krishna is God who is extremely loving. And he is a person who descends to this world periodically to attract us to him. And not only that, he is also always present in our heart with us. You know, even if a person loves us very much, and even if that person holds us in the tightest of hugs, that person cannot be as close to us as Krishna always is to us. He is in our hearts, always. And he's such a loving God. How far is Krishna from us? What do you think? How far is Krishna from us? He's in our hearts. Yes, he's in our hearts, he's very close. Actually, Krishna is close to us but we are far away from him because our hearts, our desires are turned away from him. But even now, Krishna is just one thought away from us. If we think about him, we connect with him. If we think about him, we can feel his presence. So the whole process of bhakti yoga is the process of turning our heart, which is turned away from Krishna, towards Krishna. In Sanskrit, the word is bahirmukha and unmukha. So we are face is turned away from Krishna right now, and we are meant to turn towards Krishna. And when we turn towards Krishna, we start perceiving and relishing Krishna's sweetness. And that brings the supreme happiness in life. Bhakti paresha anubhava viraktir anyatra cha. Once we start experiencing Krishna, and the process of bhakti yoga is the process by which we experience Krishna. Bhakti para isha anubhava. It gives us experience of that Lord who is transcendental. And when we experience that, it is so fulfilling that viraktir anyatra cha. Don't feel interested in anyone else. Say in youth, people want to form relationships with someone. So everybody is out trying to find their dream partner. You know, Mr. Right or Miss Right or whatever. Now if suppose, after a lot of searching, somebody finds someone. Yes, we are so compatible, we just like each other. And then, if they really like each other, if they are really interested in pursuing a relationship with each other, then if their attraction or the relationship is real, then they will stop being interested in other people. Now, no more exploring. Now, I want to deepen this relationship. So, similarly, when we authentically connect with Krishna, then we lose interest in enjoying worldly things. It's not that we have to give up worldly things, but we don't think of worldly things as our sources of pleasure. See, Krishna is the supreme source of love and pleasure. So, this process of turning our heart from the world to Krishna, this is the process of bhakti yoga. And the bhakti tradition is a tradition which helps us, which passes down this method of how to love Krishna. So there are gurus and there are disciples. And the gurus and disciples, they are linked together by the principle of loving Krishna. The teachers, they are absorbed in love for Krishna. And by seeing them, the students, they become inspired to love Krishna. And then the students, they become teachers. And they are filled with love for Krishna, and then they inspire their students to love Krishna. So, the bhakti tradition is a tradition of, it's a link of hearts. A link of hearts means that the heart is linked with the common, with love for Krishna and love for those who want to love Krishna. And over generation after generation, there have been great saints who have passed on this tradition. Who have continued this tradition and expanded this tradition. And Krishna is telling us this is an ancient tradition. Puta bahavo jnana tapasa puta madbhava magata. Many, many people in the past have become purified by practicing bhakti and by sharing bhakti, inspiring others to practice bhakti. So this is the living bhakti tradition is that tradition which inspires people to also devote themselves to Krishna. Srila Prabhupada was an extraordinary exponent of bhakti. He had so much love for Krishna that thousands and thousands, even millions of people across the world, just by associating with him or associating with those who were associating with him, they became inspired to love Krishna. And in loving Krishna, they gained life's greatest fulfillment. So, this is I'll speak in three parts. This is the first part about the living bhakti tradition. Any questions, any comments, any reflections? Anyone like to say something? Anything that struck you, anything that raised a question in you?
I liked what you said. I liked a lot of things, but in the beginning, because I was just watching a documentary where they were saying that when they find like very old archaeological finds, then and they don't fit in the scientific scientific idea, then they don't want to acknowledge it. So there's so much proof, but they don't want to put it in their scientific way of thinking.
Like they have that's true.
Way to
Yeah, there was a philosopher of science who said that the theories which we like, we call them facts. The facts we don't like, we call them theories. So yes, there is a knowledge filter where there's a particular worldview that is there, then we take those things which fit into this worldview and we neglect those things. So yes, so the glory of antiquity, there is a good amount of evidence for that. But somehow that gets neglected. Yeah, thank you. Any other thoughts or comments? Any questions? Okay, so thank you. So I'll move on. Now, the bhakti tradition is a living tradition meant to inspire us to love Krishna. So, the idea of a tradition as a museum, what does that mean? In a museum, we go to see how things were in the past. Oh, this was like this, this was like this, this was art done by this person. This is a handicraft done by this person. This is like this. So the beauty of a museum is based on how things are preserved, how things were in the past and how they are preserved. So some people think of tradition also in that way. That okay, things were like this and they need to be preserved. In today's world, there is a significant group of people who identify themselves as SBNR. Has anyone heard this word SBNR? SBNR is spiritual but not religious. Oh. They say that, yeah, we want to be spiritual but no religion. We don't know. So their idea is that if you're religious, then you're narrow-minded, you're dogmatic, you're fanatical, you're caught in rituals, you're just blindly adhering to certain dogmas. I don't want to be religious, but I want to be spiritual. I want to be open-minded. I want to develop my consciousness. I want to explore higher reality. So when people have this idea that spiritual but not religious, they come up with a certain idea of religion, and they get that idea of religion because they have experienced religion primarily as a museum. That means some people think that, okay, in the past we did things like this. So if you have to be faithful to our religion, this is what we have to do. When people are religious but not spiritual, they get very caught in externals. They get very caught in externals. The externals could just be the external practices that they are doing, or the externals could also be certain dogmas that they adhere to, without really considering what is the purpose of those practices or even the purpose of those beliefs. So for example, some religions have the idea that they say that, you know, we are the only way to God. So Christians may say Jesus is the only way to God. Now some people they'll say only this part. Others say that if you're not following God, then you're going to go to hell. And there are even more extremist people, they will say that if you are not following us, you are not only going to go to hell, we will help you get there faster. So, now it's said that God wants spiritual fruits, not religious nuts. So, there are some people who are so fanatical. Now, there are statements like this. Yes, in the Bible there is a statement that none shall go to the Father except through me. But we have to see these statements in context. If there is a patient and the patient goes to a doctor and the doctor diagnoses the patient and then gives a prescription. And that time the patient starts saying, but you know doctor, I went to this doctor and he said this and I went to that doctor and she said like this. And this patient is the embodiment of confusion. Oh, this person said. Then the doctor may say, just forget everything that everyone told you. Just take this medicine, you'll get cured. Now, when the doctor is saying this, the doctor's statement doesn't imply that all the other doctors are false. All that it implies is, right now if you are here, you take this medicine, you will be cured. So similarly, in every tradition, there are some statements like this. Just focus on this, just follow this, you will get purified, you will get purified, you will attain God. Such statements are not statements of absolute truth which reject all other paths. They are statements meant to create focus. If they were statements like that, that they were statements of absolute fact, that it would make God himself actually very cruel. Why? Because there are so many people who are born if there is only one way to God, and there are so many people who are born, who live and die in remote parts of the world where they never come to know about that path, and they die and they go to hell. So that means actually it was not their deed that sent them to hell. It is just their life was arranged in such a way that they are born in a God-forsaken place and they go to hell. So actually this idea makes God cruel. So some people just get no chance at all. So our understanding is that if we consider climbing up a mountain, then the bottom of the mountain is material consciousness. The top of the mountain is spiritual consciousness. And there are different paths up the mountain. So some paths may be good for some people, some paths may be not so suited for some people. The important thing is to climb up the mountain. So there are some people who, when they say spiritual, I want to be spiritual but not religious. It's like saying, okay, I want to get to the top of the mountain, but I don't want to follow any path up the mountain. Well, you have to follow some path. How will you get to the top of the mountain? So if we consider religion as just a set of dogmatic beliefs and ritualistic practices, then we may say, why should I follow it? But if we see religion as a means to raise our consciousness, then we can be religious without becoming fanatical. So when people have this idea that religion is like a museum, now this understanding can be there among insiders and it can be there among outsiders also. So skeptics and atheists, they may say that, hey, you religious people, you're just outdated people. You believe outdated things, you have outdated practices, and you just don't belong to the 21st century. Now they are having the museum idea of religion. The museum idea is that religion is about just some outdated practices. But I was in Australia and it was an interfaith discussion, panel discussion, and the title of the discussion was why hasn't God died till now? Now what does that mean? That since the 19th century almost, there have been thinkers who have been predicting the death of God. Friedrich Nietzsche was a German philosopher who famously said, God is dead. So since that time, people have been believing, at least the mainstream scientific narrative was that, as rationality will increase, the irrationality of religion will go down. And in that they presume that God doesn't exist, but God as a concept, people stop believing in it also. Religion will die out. So the discussion was, why hasn't God died till now? That means, why is religion still existing? Not only existing, religion is resurgent. America is among the most religious countries in the world. Middle East is quite religious. India is religious. After in USSR, after communism fell, there's been an enormous resurgence in religion. So our devotees in Ukraine, if we go for classes over there, they have small temple, and the temple hall is full, and devotees are peering in through the windows and hearing the classes. There's so much enthusiasm for practicing bhakti. So the idea is that there has been a resurgence. Why is that? Because religion is serving some need of people. I started by talking about how the software of the mind is being corrupted. So religious practices in one way or the other are helping people to find some peace, find some inner calm, some anchor in their lives. There's an article in the New York Times which said how in the mainstream churches in America, God has been rebranded. Rebranded means, in the past, the idea was God was the cosmic supplier. O Father, thou art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, give us our daily bread. So the idea is that God is our supplier who will give us bread. But now for most people, they're not worried about bread. The Western world at least has developed sufficiently that people are worried of many things, but not so much about bread. So then God is the cosmic supplier is not so relevant for people. So the major image that emerges from the mainstream churches in America is not God as a cosmic supplier, but God as a cosmic therapist. God as a cosmic therapist means you approach God, you pray to God, you connect with God, you will become more peaceful, you will become more calm, you will become more joyful. This is not just a reason for people turning towards religion. Even Eastern spirituality is mindfulness meditation, yoga practice, chanting of mantras, especially kirtan is going on a big way because it is addressing a felt need of people. And that need is, it is calming people's minds. It is giving people better calm, clarity and control in their inner worlds. So from the outsider perspective, those who thought that religion will just die out, they have been surprised because religion has not only survived, but it has increased. So those who criticize religion, they condemn religion, they often have, you could say, a cartoon depiction of religion. Oh, you people believe in such irrational things. Now, it is not those irrational things that attract people to Krishna or people to God in any way. It is the experience of some calmness, some strength, some shelter by connection with God. That is what attracts people to come. Now, insiders can also have this this museum conception of religion. What does that mean? I mean, only if you believe this, then you are right. Otherwise, you are wrong. There's once a nun who was taking care of young orphan girls, and she was in charge of that school. And as a young girl grew up, she became a teenager, and she was going to college. So she asked her, what do you want to become? So she said, I want to become a prostitute. What? Oh God, oh Hail Mary, whatever. Girl, what did you say? He said, I want to become a prostitute. Oh, thank God. I thought he wanted to become a Protestant. So sometimes people may get so caught in their own internal debates that there can be you could say mental crimes and moral crimes or mental wrongs. Mental wrong means this is my conception of how things should be, and if you are doing it like that, you are wrong. It is a mental wrong. A moral wrong is something which is morally not right to do. So sometimes people may get so caught in their own ideas of what is right that they may condemn others just because of some small thing which they think they are doing is wrong. So this sort of idea where people get caught in the externals, that is what leads to fanaticism. Fanaticism means that in every religious tradition, there are certain things which are central and certain things which are peripheral. We could say certain things which are principles, which are universal, certain things which are preferences, which are contextual. So when those which are peripheral, those things are made into the central, and people are forced to do those things, that is when that religion becomes fanatical. So when we become fanatical, we hold on to the peripheral things, we forget the central things, and we keep fighting among the peripheral things. So the museum understanding of religion, it makes religion the object of criticism by outsiders, and the museum understanding of religion makes insiders, practitioners, fanatical. Now, if you are not doing this, you are wrong. If you are not doing this, you are wrong. If you are not doing this, you are wrong. Sometimes as devotees also, we practicing bhakti, we can become very judgmental about others. If you are not doing this, you are condemned. If you are not doing this, you are condemned. It's sometimes some devotees, if we meet them, they have a certain idea of how a devotee should be. And if you are not like that, they condemn others. It's almost like they question the very basis of your existence. How dare you exist? So sometimes when this museum understanding becomes too much, we can become terribly judgmental. So I talked about religious nuts. These are people who hold on to the museum understanding of religion, and they are there in every tradition. It's not that some particular religions may have them more, some may have them less, but they are there in every tradition. And yeah, okay, good point.
I'm thinking, why do we call it museum?
Museum means they think this is how it is and this is how it should be, everything. So, say for example, Protestants and Catholics, they have some ideological differences. In the past, before the Protestants came, there were only Catholics existing. So, Catholics are often quite very critical of Protestants, Protestants are very critical of Catholics. The idea is that Catholics think if you are not believing God in this way, if you are not following the Bible in this way, then you are like a demon. So, to consider somebody as a prostitute better than a Protestant, that is what are we doing? We are thinking this has to be like this only. So, museum means everything is preserved like a fossil. So, museum, that is the idea of just preservation like a fossil. There is no dynamism, there is no understanding of the purpose and how the purpose is to be served. So, with the fossil understanding, we have a stereotype. This is how things should be. This is the only way to God. If somebody is doing something else, you are doomed, like that.
Okay.
Yeah. So, this is the second part about the understanding of the bhakti tradition or religion as a museum. So, before I move to the third part about garden, any thoughts, comments, questions?
I have a question. The word bhakti, what is that? What is the meaning of that?
Okay, good question. So, what does the word bhakti mean? The word bhakti refers to devotion. It means devotion, it comes from the Sanskrit word bhag, which means to divide. So, the idea is that that when we live in the world, our love gets divided among many, many things. We may love our pets, we may love our family members, we may love our hobbies, we may love our nation. But bhakti gives us a vision by which we see that all lovable things ultimately come from one supremely loving source. So, bhakti is the process by which we learn to love the supreme, love Krishna. So, bhakti is the process which involves some certain practices by which our heart's connection with Krishna can be developed. Okay, thank you. Any other comments? Yes, please.
So, in our preaching, how should we approach those who are religious to some extent? You know, they might be Christians by family, or they might be of other religions. But maybe they are not finding satisfaction within their religion, and you know, what if they come across bhakti and how do we preach to them?
So, if there are people from other religious traditions, how do we present bhakti to them? Actually, Prabhupada did not encounter, say, Muslims much, because that world is quite closed. They don't allow us to preach in that. But we can look at his interactions with Muslims, with Christians rather. So, broadly, if somebody were a committed Christian, somebody is already a priest in a particular tradition or a teacher of a particular tradition, then Srila Prabhupada did not, he said that, you know, we are teaching principles of love of God. So, he even said that Jesus is also our guru. He had so much love of God, he is ready to lay down his life for the sake of God. And somebody who has so much love, that they are our guru. So, Prabhupada had profound reverence for Jesus. And then he would encourage Christians to follow Jesus' teachings more faithfully. And Prabhupada presented Krishna consciousness as a method for elevating one's consciousness. So, our purpose is not to convert people horizontally from one religion to another. If there is any conversion to be had, it is to be vertically. from being materialist to being spiritualist. So if somebody is already committed to climbing up the mountain on by a particular path, then we don't have to pull them down from that path and make them climb up from our path. So we encourage them, yes, that is the destination, and follow this path. Follow your path properly and you can rise up. But there are some people who are just nominal religionists. Nominalism, they're just born in a particular family. So I was with a devotee, he was telling his experiences that he's born in a Jewish family. So he was talking about, after he became introduced to Krishna Bhakti, he was talking with his extended family at a get together about his bhakti practices. So he said, so his uncle asked him suspiciously, are you trying to convert me? He knew that his uncle was an atheist. So he said, I didn't know that you belong to any religion. He said, I'm a Jew, I'm an atheist, but I'm an atheist Jew. Now, if you consider Judaism, the first commandment is to love God with all thy heart, all thy soul. If somebody doesn't accept God itself, then how are you a Jew? So here, I am a Jew, this is not a religious designation, it is almost like a material designation, cultural designation or racial designation. It's just a material identification. It's not a religious path at all. So if somebody is nominally religious, that means they were just born at the bottom of a particular path, and that's what they have been there. They never taken any steps up along that path also. Then Prabhupada encouraged them to take up the path of bhakti. As I said, in the bhakti path, the conception of God is revealed much more attractively. There are much more details about who God is, how he is so at all attractive. And the process of moving towards him is also more systematically outlined. There is an understanding in all religions that we should love God, but how do we love God? What are the practices that we adopt by which we can love God? So, if we can present it in a way that is non-sectarian, but at the same time, we tell that what we have found in our experience as the facilities or the support systems, the supports that we have while climbing up the mountain from this way. So if they feel inspired to climb up the mountain from that way, that's also fine. But our purpose is not just to increase the ranks of a particular organization. Our purpose is to raise people's consciousness. So we accept the validity of other paths also. And we, in our experience, have found a particular path potent in raising our consciousness, and we also found it intellectually appealing. It is intellectually answers many questions, it gives us a good understanding of God, of life, of the path to God. And that's why we can recommend this path to others. So if somebody was just a nominal religionist, Prabhupada would encourage them to start practicing Krishna Bhakti, but not in a mood of rejecting their earlier tradition. We see that, yeah, that tradition, whatever I was in, that prepared the groundwork, and now I am taking this path forwards. Okay, thank you. Any other questions or comments?
Yeah. So how do we deal with things that are like a big part of Christianity, like the holy days and stuff? It's all about drinking and meat eating and stuff.
Yeah.
So how do we deal then with that part, like where someone is like a serious spiritualist or like a serious religious person, a Christian, but at the same time, like...
That's true.
Does
that's
have a... all these practices which...
I understand.
Our tradition is not even a beginning of understanding. So how do you deal with that then?
That's true. So if somebody is in a Christian tradition where all the festivals center on drinking and doing other things,
which are not even drinking, but just meat eating.
Meat eating or something like that, which is just so there is no practice of spirituality at all. In that, how do you do that?
In a way that I think any Hindu would understand, as I understand it, and on the banks of in Benares, I was sitting on the bank, and I mentioned this to a gentleman who was passing by, and he says, oh yes, it is clear from the Sermon of the Mount of the Liminary, surrounded by sadhus naked, and it's clear from the Sermon of the Mount that the Lord, Jesus Christ, was an avatar. if you see these distinctions, maybe you're just we're just lost in our own duality, right? The confusion's within us.
My specific question was more about behavior, not too much
yeah,
about
I think, yeah.
spiritual
path. I think like, let's take both of these one by one. I agree with this.
Yeah.
So yeah. yeah. yeah, so I with respect to
something?
Yeah, okay.
I was born in Brazil, I was raised as a Catholic. And I have an aunt, she's very religious. She wakes up at 3 o'clock in the morning to pray. And she has a daughter that I preached to her and she became a devotee. And she was very against. But nowadays, I call her because she inspires me.
Yeah.
You know? Even though she hates me. But she's so devout, she always has positive things.
Mm.
To
yeah.
And
yeah.
I can see it's because of her devotion.
Yeah. It's just, see, this is a.
I don't preach for her.
Yeah, I understand.
Like in the example.
I get your
point. She helps me because of her devotion.
Yeah. See, with respect to Christians, thank you for that comment. With respect to Christians who eat meat, then that's such an integral part of their culture. Then are they actually making any spiritual advancement? So we have to, we cannot go into any interaction imposing our frame of thinking on others. So there is, in logic, there is something called as the error of the antecedent. Error of the antecedent means that if A, then B. Then if I say therefore B is there, so A must be there. So for example, if it rains, my pavement will be wet. So then, if my pavement is wet, therefore it must have rained. Well, that's not true. My pavement may be wet because maybe there's a leakage from my house pipe system, water system, or somebody spilled water over there. So my point is that certainly if it rains, there will be water over there. But the only way for water to be there is not rains alone. So similarly, abstain. If in this context, if I apply A is abstaining from meat eating, B is spiritual consciousness. So in general, if we learn to be sensitive and conscious that other life forms are also conscious, they are also life. They are also being given life by God, and we shouldn't kill them. That enhancement of our consciousness, which is A, will lead to B. That will lead to greater spiritual consciousness. But we can't take it backwards and say that if A is not there, B can't be there at all. That means the water can get, the pavement can be wet by other factors also. So sometimes some people may be eating meat because that's just the culture in which they are brought up in. But they may be, the rest of their life may be such that they are actually kind-hearted, they are compassionate, they are sensitive, they are cultured, and in their own way they are devoted to God. So then we have to appreciate people as they are right now. Yes, so even there may be Christians who may be very, as you said, somebody wakes up early in the morning, does their devotions very diligently. So we can't just minimize and trivialize it all saying that, oh, you eat meat. If they have the devotion, they have it, and we appreciate that. What we can also say is that if they also gave up eating meat, they could go further up in their journey. And even in the Vedic tradition, broadly speaking, it was not that meat eating was absolutely forbidden. It is that if you see in the 11th canto, there is a verse where it says that intoxication, meat eating, and sexuality, illicit sexuality, womanizing, these are common tendencies in human beings. But those who want to seek spirituality, they decrease it. A Esha tu bhutanam nivruttistu mahafalam. Esha pravruttir bhutanam nivruttistu mahafalam. It says that this is the general tendency of people. But those who can give these up, nivruttistu mahafalam, they will get a great fruit. And in the Bhagavatam also, in the first canto, Prabhupada is describing about the king Rantidev. He gives a brief biographical sketch. And there Prabhupada says that although Rantidev was a Kshatriya, he never ate meat. It's an interesting statement. That means normally Kshatriyas would eat meat. See, it's not that, what Prabhupada's point was, nobody ever had organized slaughterhouses where they would kill millions of people. See, Kshatriyas would have to go to the forest. And if they are on military expedition, generally we can nourish our body with grains also adequately. But if somebody is traveling through forests, traveling through deserts, traveling through different areas, you cannot carry a big stock of grains with you. Yeah. And grains don't just go naturally grow. Fruits may grow, and fruits and roots can nourish forest sieges. But those who are warriors have to fight. Mm-hmm. If they are not going to get grains, then what are they going to do?
There's something especially bad about the slaughterhouses. Right?
Yeah, so it's
not really like a
so the yeah, it's true. Dark. See the meat. If you see even naturally, nature has given us canine teeth. Mm? But it's only all our teeth are not canine teeth. It's only few teeth are canine. So that means we can eat meat, but traditionally and physiologically, meat was always a small part of people's diet. But now with organized slaughterhouses, millions and millions of animals are killed and meat has become like a part of every meal for people. So that kind of excessive disproportionate killing of animals, that has no precedent in the past history, and that is not good for health also, what to speak of consciousness. So we can encourage people to try out vegetarianism. But we don't have to prejudge people because this person is eating meat. Therefore, that person cannot have any spirituality. We can't prejudge people like that.
Yeah, I was thinking of saying the example of meat eating, but I'm thinking in my own life, like the things that I'm doing that block me from being in connection with Krishna.
So that's true.
It has, of course, many different levels. And
yeah, it's
yeah.
true. It's true. Good point. So, yeah, it's Alison. It's 1 minute. Your comment about, you know, Christians, they consider Jesus to be God incarnate, and Hindus also consider to be.
Many of the mainline Christians, it's like a museum, you know, it's a tradition. I have a mainline religion and I understand that. It's like, that's the museum aspect of it, which is not bad. It's just that's all it is, it's ephemeral, right? It's not a spiritual exercise. But it took me a while to figure that out. But you know, many Christians are in fact not impersonalists; they're personalists.
Yeah.
They may not be aware of it, by the way, if they haven't thought about it. But you know, they take it very seriously. That is the definition of a Christian.
Yeah.
He or she believes that God is both human and divine. Jesus Christ is both human and divine.
Yeah.
And that's a uniquely they don't. But you know, later in the 3rd century, Christians decided that they never expanded that into the idea that there are other avatars and joined all the rest of us, right? But they were a phenomenally successful cult of neo-Hindus with a fragment of scripture. I have this vision of, you know, the good Lord is accustomed when he manifests himself as an avatar to be welcomed, right? And that did happen to Jesus Christ. He went to a different group of people that never had an avatar before, prepped them a couple of millennium by telling them they'd get an avatar, they'd get the Messiah, a messenger, sent the avatar, and what did they do? The religious class, the Brahmins in the temple, they're Brahmins, got together with the Romans and they killed him. They didn't honor him as a deity. They didn't recognize, right? Until, you know, so they're just other Hindus. I mean, they're not that different. You know what I mean? There's lots of lost Hindus, too. You know, they're mesmerized by their watch and their BMW and their big World Bank job. You know, or people that
that's true.
People and materialists of every religious tradition.
Yeah.
And race and creed.
Yeah, the Christians are personalists, definitely. I think the main challenge is that after accepting Jesus as the savior, mainstream Christianity to some extent shifted from living a ethical life to becoming theologically harmonious. I mean, if you just believe that Jesus has died for us and he has saved us, we are saved. If you look at Jesus' own life and teachings, he focused more on ethics. In most of his parables, he certainly as a teacher, you have to have faith in him. But somehow in mainstream Christianity now, the act of accepting Jesus as the savior, that has become paramount. Living an ethical life has not, it has been downplayed to some extent. It is not in all traditions, in all Christian traditions, but to some extent that has happened. We, and as you said, that this, that the broad Vedic tradition has no problem in accepting Jesus as a way to God. But the way Christianity is understood today, they have a lot of problems accepting anyone outside their tradition as a way to God. That's how that is. So that's how it has become, some places it becomes a little intolerant and fanatical. But otherwise, as a way for personally raising one's consciousness, yes, there are Christians who do practice and they do raise their consciousness in whatever way they can. It may not be huge, but then as you rightly said, even among Hindus, like if say, if Christmas is more about Santa Claus than Jesus, if you consider in India, Diwali is more about firecrackers than about Lord Ram. So that kind of externalization is possible in all religions. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Muslims also have a bhakti tradition. It's called Sufism, and I've been to Sufi mosques, and it's wonderful. You know, they get on big horns, they blow, and they make a lot of noise, they beat the drums, and they send people around, drummers around to collect people. They all come around. There's a congregation. A guy goes around with a whip. Ceremoniously beats a circle, you know, it's pretty easy to stay out of his way. And then, you know, the dervishes come on and they dance and everyone's chanting and singing. And when everyone is sort of a bit like being in our temple, and when everyone's totally stoned for the devotion, out comes the food. And this is a hungry country, it's the middle of the desert. You know, you're there, you're not from there when they still love you. And so there are, joyous people of all persuasions that are. I can get worried about that, but I think it's true, and we shouldn't get hung up in minor differences in dogma and doctrine.
Yeah, thank you.
Don't take it too seriously.
Yeah. That's true.
Oh.
Thank you. So, moving on to the last part, thank you for your comments. So, and moving on to the last part now about really about the tradition as a garden. So a garden is a place where we want to grow, and the purpose is very clear. So for example, in India Tulsi grows, and Tulsi is considered very sacred. Now we want to grow Tulsi in America. The purpose is clear, but if we just keep Tulsi outside, in India Tulsi may grow wonderfully, here it may not grow wonderfully. Here, many devotees, they want to grow tulsi, they have some artificial lighting, and they keep the tulsi in light, especially when it's very cold. So we are clear about the purpose, and then whatever is required for fulfilling that purpose, we do that. Now if somebody goes from America to India and they say, oh, you keep light for tulsi, I'll also keep light for my tulsi. But in India, if you put a light for tulsi, tulsi will get dried over there. Isn't it? So we don't need that. So the idea is that the purpose is we want to grow. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used the metaphor of fruits of love of God, that we all want our heart to be filled with love for Krishna. And the garden understanding of the bhakti tradition is that in every place, what is required for the plant of devotion, the creeper of devotion to grow, and for it to give the give the flowers and the fruits. That is what should be done. So Srila Prabhupada was expert in this. When he came to America, he recognized that the American culture was so different from Indian culture that many of the practices which were common in India, he did not necessarily bring them over here. Say, for example, consider the basic one, a temple itself. In India, building a temple means you have to make sure that there is a particular kind of tower, spire on top, the deities are in a particular direction, facing a particular direction. There are so many standards which are to be seen when somebody is building a temple. Now, Prabhupada, when he came to America, he had practically no resources. So, he said the essence of a temple is that it is a place for glorifying Krishna. And that's why sometimes he got places, the first place where he started was just a storefront. There's nothing externally sacred about it. But from there, Prabhupada was able to attract hundreds and hundreds of people. And the Lower East Side, which is in New York, from there we see that it's the place where everything began. So, right from now, when Prabhupada had the facility, he established beautiful temples with nice traditional architecture. But the essence of the temple is not the architecture of the temple. The essence of the temple is who is worshipped in the temple and how that person is worshipped. Whether by coming to the temple, people are developing love for God. So, same way with practices. Certain practices, say for example, with respect to culture, Prabhupada, when he came to America, he found that the men and women, they were the traditional gender roles were not so common. And women used to do everything that men would do. Then Prabhupada engaged women also in all services. Traditionally, a single woman would not even go out of their homes alone. They would be chaperoned by someone. But when Prabhupada started the Krishna Bhakti movement, he had young women going out for distributing books. So, the idea is that we are all meant to serve Krishna. In a traditional culture, we may develop our devotion in a particular way. In another culture, we may develop the devotion in a different way. The idea is, we are not necessarily for a culture or against a culture. We are for Krishna. And however we can practice Krishna Bhakti in whatever situation we are in, we practice that. And we move forward. So, when Prabhupada came back in 1968 from India, 65 he came to America, 66 he started ISKCON, 67 he had a stroke because of which he had to go back to India, and then 68 he came back, and after that the movement really exploded. So, 68 when he came back, in New York, the devotees had a globe, globe which is there, and Prabhupada looked at the globe and all his young disciples, most of them were 20, 21, 22, something like that, he told all of them, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted, the Lord wanted that the whole world be spiritualized. So, all of you pick up one country. Go to that country and share Krishna Bhakti over there. And one of the ladies over there, Jadurani Mataji, says, Prabhupada, what about us girls? And Prabhupada said, we are not boys or girls, we are souls. We are servants of Krishna. You also pick up one country. So, the idea is that Prabhupada, his purpose was very clear. His purpose was to help people develop love for Krishna and to inspire others to develop love for Krishna. And whatever was required for that, he did that. I'll conclude with two examples of Prabhupada's resourcefulness in his creativity, his resourcefulness in presenting Krishna Bhakti in a way that would inspire people to cultivate the garden of their hearts. So, once a hippie was stoned on drugs, came to Prabhupada, and Prabhupada had just given a talk about the spiritual world and how there is so much bliss in the spiritual world. So, Swami asked, what is the bliss of Vaikuntha? He was this person who had come a little bit to programs, he knew a little bit. What is the bliss of Vaikuntha like? And Prabhupada could have quoted from Shastra. He could have quoted, Chintamani Prakarasadmashu Kalpa Vruksha. Oh, there are desire fulfilling trees, there are cows who give unlimited milk. Now, that would not make much sense to somebody who is high on drugs. So, Prabhupada told him, Vaikuntha is like an ocean of LSD. So, now, somebody who has that museum understanding, they may ask, you know, in which scripture is Vaikuntha's joy compared to LSD? No, LSD is a drug, it is tamasic, this is divya, this is transcendent, how do you compare it? See, the point is not just to get it right. The point is to get it across. To get it across. The essential point is that there is so much happiness in the spiritual world. So for somebody whose conception of happiness is in terms of drugs, then there's an ocean of that kind of happiness. Oh, really? I want to go there. So when we hear about the spiritual world, when we hear about spirituality, the whole idea is that the desire for spiritual growth needs to be triggered within us. And if that desire is triggered, then that is the success. So when we practice Krishna Bhakti, or when we share Krishna Bhakti, if we have this garden understanding, then garden understanding of bhakti, then we will see how we can nourish the fruit of bhakti in our hearts and how we can nourish it in others' hearts. At one time, Prabhupada told the devotee, Tamal Krishna Maharaj, and Tamal Krishna tells this in his memories, that I inherited the legacy of my spiritual master. Now, Prabhupada's spiritual master was Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and he had built Gaudiya Math, which had a very vibrant preaching. They had 64 centers in India and 3 outside India. But after Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur's departure in 1937, the whole mission fractured. And externally speaking, Prabhupada did not get anything. Normally, the spiritual master legacy could have been, he got the charge of a temple, he got some devotees who would assist him, he got some funds. So Prabhupada did not get anything at all. Then what did he mean when he said, I got the legacy, I inherited the legacy of my spiritual master? That legacy that Prabhupada got was the desire to love Krishna and the desire to share love for Krishna. So now, in a sense, Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur had given that instruction to everyone. You know, share Krishna Bhakti in the Western world. But Prabhupada took that desire more seriously than anyone else. And when he took that desire very seriously, from his very strong desire to glorify Krishna, temples emerged, books emerged, devotees emerged. Everything came from that. And when Prabhupada was departing from the world, several Indians asked him, Swamiji, are you going to appoint a successor? So Prabhupada did appoint administratively a GBC body, and he appointed some successor gurus. But Prabhupada did not appoint one successor. And he answered the question differently. One time an Indian well-wisher asked him, who will be your successor? And Prabhupada replied, whoever wants to be. Whoever wants to be doesn't mean there's a free-for-all, everybody will fight and whoever is the strongest. No, whoever wants to be means that whoever takes up this mission of loving Krishna and sharing love for Krishna, they will become the successors. So the tradition is not centered on temples or on books. Tradition is not centered on any externals. Externals are important, but their purpose is they help us to develop the internal. So if we have this understanding of bhakti as a garden, where the fruit of love of God is to be cultivated, then we will have the priority clear in our own life as well as in our sharing with others. Sometimes if you start feeling that, oh, in this situation I can't do this, okay, then what can I do right now? I cannot do this, but I can do this. If we think bhakti means I have to do these things, if I can't do this, then I cannot practice bhakti. No. In this situation, my work pressure is so much, or my family situation is so demanding, I can't go to the temple. But bhakti is not just about going to the temple. In my home also I can practice bhakti. I can still... So if we have this understanding of bhakti as inclusive, the purpose is to connect with Krishna, purpose is to love Krishna, then whatever situation we may be in, we can practice bhakti and move towards Krishna. So the living tradition is what will bring transformation in our hearts, and will become bring transformation in the hearts of many, many others. So it is this tradition that we all are a part of by Prabhupada's mercy and by the mercy of Prabhupada's followers. And we all can experience the transformation of the heart, the enrichment of the heart, the sublime satisfaction that comes by connecting with Krishna. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke on the theme of the living bhakti tradition is a garden, not a museum. So I talked about, started with how Krishna descends to provide a pathway by which people can love him and ultimately attain him. So tradition is an integral part of human society. Even science, which began by rejecting tradition, has created tradition of its own. Now, science caters for our external needs in terms of providing control over externals, but the internal mind is going wild today. And religion is resurgent in today's world because religion is helping people address their inner needs for calmness, for meaning, for purpose. Now, when atheists or skeptics criticize religion as being outdated, unscientific, irrational, they have a museum idea of religion. It's a cartoonized version of religion where they say that you people are just outdated. But religion is meant to address people's eternal needs and people's felt needs. And this, because it's like a garden which nourishes the heart, and people feel their heart being nourished. That's why even if the world says that this is unscientific or whatever, people keep practicing. It is a supreme science. And insiders also may get caught in this museum idea of religion, where they may start thinking that, oh, if you don't follow this, if you don't believe this, then you are a deviant. Then they may, that, so that kind of, when we hold on to externals, when we take things which are peripheral and make them as central, then we become fanatical. So the essence of the bhakti tradition is what? Is raising our consciousness. It, like, the bottom of the mountain is material consciousness, top of the mountain is spiritual consciousness. There can be different paths up the mountain, but the important thing is to rise up the mountain. And for this journey, what is the bhakti tradition offers us a very clear, beautiful revelation of God's all attractiveness. It also offers us a very well charted out path for moving towards Krishna. And the bhakti tradition is essentially a link of the hearts. The teachers love Krishna and they inspire the students to love Krishna. The students love Krishna, they become teachers and they inspire others to love Krishna. So in this tradition of love, when we practice bhakti, if we operate with the museum understanding, we may become too judgmental about others and we may alienate others. So those with the museum understanding of bhakti, they become religious nuts. They don't really relish spiritual fruits. Then I concluded with talking about the garden understanding of bhakti. In the garden understanding, the idea is that the heart is to be cultivated so that love is developed. And just as the same plant for cultivating in different environments will require different conditions appropriately. Similarly, the practices that we have, the specifics can vary depending on whether they are nourishing the heart. So Prabhupada was so dynamic that he, even if the temple, the external was not there, but the purpose of the temple was served. So unless a traditional temple is built, what is the use of having a temple? That is the museum understanding. But if Krishna is glorified, then everything is wonderful. That is the garden understanding. And then I talked about Prabhupada's expertise. The point is not just to get it right, but to get it across. So he said, Vaikuntha is like the bliss of Vaikuntha is like an ocean of LSD. And Prabhupada's accommodating people according to their culture to practice bhakti. That is all an example of his resourcefulness. And when Prabhupada says that I got the legacy of my spiritual master, that legacy was not in terms of external property or resources. It was in terms of the internal desire to love Krishna and to inspire others to love Krishna. And that is a legacy that each one of us can inherit, and we can enrich our hearts and we can enrich the hearts of others. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So, is there any one or two questions, or should we stop here? Or any comments as such?
It's a question.
Okay. Please have questions. You can ask some questions then. Okay. Yes, please.
You might say there are principles, they are not really.
Yeah, of course. Like what? What do you have in mind?
Deity worship standard, you could say, or you know, how, even about his idea, maybe not in his practices, but in his purpose, he clearly talked about how the women should be mostly taking care of the family and kids are the priority.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, which I agree. But like maybe there are some things that which have to be preserved, and if conditions are like you're saying, if conditions are not suitable, then we act in a certain other way. But if conditions are suitable, in US also nowadays it's more suitable. In that case,
okay.
Should we enforce?
Okay, good point.
Details?
So, is it that say, if the conditions are suitable, then the tradition externals can also be enforced? Say, for example, women doing traditional family gender roles, say, taking care of the family. Now, there is no should over here. There is what works. So, that means that the Krishna consciousness movement is primarily an inspirational movement. It is not a legislational movement. You cannot legislate faith. So, we are not like a police state which I tell you, you should do this, you should not do this. There are certain practices of bhakti which we have to do. And that's how connects us with Krishna. That's why we have our sadhana bhakti, we have our initiation vows. But we cannot, nobody can micro control everyone's life. So, it's not practical and it's not desirable also. Krishna also gives everyone free will. So, every person according to their situation has to find out how best we can serve Krishna. So, we are not saying that traditional gender roles are bad or traditional gender roles are essential. The important thing is you practice bhakti, whatever way we can. So, if in a particular family, the traditional gender roles, it was a tradition and it survived because it served a purpose. Now, no tradition, if it doesn't serve a purpose, it will not survive. So, yes, if there is a natural division of labor, where the women are the homemakers and the men are the breadwinners. Now, that is a system that has worked for many, many generations. I mean, because it has worked, that's why it's continued. So, now it's not that we have to break from that system. But it's not that we have to insist on that only for practicing bhakti. So, if that's how each family finds that, okay, that works well, you know, you take care of this, I'll take care of this. It works well, that's fine. But nobody should feel forced to take up any role. If a woman is well educated, she has ambition, and if you want to be a devotee, then you have to give up your job and practice, just be a homemaker. No, they cannot be forced like that. But if somebody wants to be a homemaker and he says, oh, you have to be modern, you have to be contemporary, what will be your prestige in society if you don't have a career yourself? Then even today's culture can force women into being professionals or having a job, otherwise you are looked down upon. So both kind of forcing people into a traditional mold and forcing people into a modern mold, both of them are undesirable. Now, everybody has their individuality and each person can find out according to their nature and their situation how best they can practice bhakti. So yes, as I said, the traditional roles served a purpose. And if they can be adopted, then that traditional system can move on. And that traditionally, children were taken care of well. And now, that may not be possible. But the point is, we cannot insist on a tradition where the situation is different. So, it happened in Afghanistan that the Taliban took power and Taliban said, no women should work. Now, because of the war over there, in many houses, the men were dead. The women were the only people who were earning money for them. And then they said, you know, who will earn in our families? They said, no, Allah will take care. Well, that is just irresponsibility. Now, God takes care, but God takes care through His representatives. So, if the real situation is so altered that whatever is traditional doesn't work, then we have to be open to alternatives. It's not that we have to indiscriminately adopt the alternatives, nor do we have to indiscriminately reject the tradition. As I said, the garden version is that our purpose is to nourish our hearts with love for Krishna and others' hearts with love for Krishna. So if women can give quality time to their children, then they can actually give very good samskaras, very good impressions in the childhood, and they can serve as a very valuable foundation for the children's lives in future. So, in that sense, the traditional gender roles can also be very favorable for cultivation of devotion in one's own heart and the other's heart also. So, but the point is that we don't have to mandate this on anyone, force this on anyone. It is something which we explain, but there is a tendency to demonize the tradition, saying that, oh, in the past women were so restricted, so deprived, so much constrained. It's not necessarily like that. Women were happy doing what they were doing. And so we cannot use a modern lens to look at the tradition. We have to look at the spiritual, with a spiritual lens, we look at the tradition and we look at modernity both. And then keeping that spiritual purpose in mind, we find out how best in our situation we can pursue the spiritual purpose. Does that make sense? Okay, thank you. You want to add something, bro? Okay. Now you have much more experience living in the Western world.
I think there's a lot of sensitivity around that issue.
Yeah, obviously.
Because of the exploitation of women. I mean, that's something that we see not just in the West, but we see it actually, it's a pandemic. And so there's a lot of sensitivity around the issue.
That is true.
And I think you said it beautifully, it's, you know, in terms of where there's an intent to develop spiritual consciousness in ourselves and in our
family members.
And that's sincere. And everything will work out just fine.
Thank you. Yes, please.
Srila Prabhupada emphasized one practice as being essential only, and that is the sankirtan of the holy name of Lord Krishna. And even it may be in a different language or a different name of God, but that was the essential one. And he gave us the idea that we may have an idea for justice, just like we're talking about modern view versus traditional view for the just society for women. But Srila Prabhupada also explained to us that it's not possible to enforce justice in this material world. There will always be opposing forces, there will always be difficulties, there will always be injustices. But if we emphasize upon the chanting of the holy name of Krishna, then people's hearts will be changed, the garden will grow, and justice will naturally grow because people will give respect to each other, desiring each other's welfare, seeing each other as spirit soul. And all of that comes from the chanting of the holy name.
Beautiful, yeah. So, thank you. Prabhupada's main emphasis was on the sankirtan, because that will raise people's consciousness and that will help people to find justice. Otherwise, at a material consciousness, it's difficult. Yeah, it's true. There's one more point here is that we don't have to see the material and the spiritual necessarily as contradictory. That means that at one level, we want to develop our spiritual consciousness and we want to help others develop spiritual consciousness. But at another level, sometimes some forms of material situations may be so unjust as to be unbearable. So, for example, we talk about tolerance. Even the Bhagavad Gita talks about tolerance. Tamas Tiksha Subharat. But in the Bhagavad Gita, it was also spoken to get Arjuna to fight a war. And that war was there because the injustice against the Pandavas was intolerable. So then, in that case, Krishna did not just tell Arjuna that you just be my devotee, worship my deity, chant Hare Krishna, and everything will be all right. Krishna also told Arjuna to fight a war. So that means that the material and the spiritual there are different ways of looking at their relationship. But we can also see that the material and spiritual are two parallel lanes. Vidyamcha vidyamcha yastad vedo bhayam saha. Prabhupada says in the Ishopanishad that, you know, with material knowledge and with spiritual knowledge, we can progress in our life. Both are needed. So, it depends on each situation and each person's nature. Some people, if some situation is unfair, they may say that, just tolerate it and move on with life. It's not a big deal. It's a small thing, let's move on in life. But sometimes, some injustices may be unbearable because they are so atrocious, they are so outrageous. Or some people themselves, by their nature, may not have that much of a thick skin to tolerate it. So then they may need to address it at a material level also. So, broadly speaking, we all need to develop tolerance and we need to pursue transcendence. So a certain amount of tolerance is required. You cannot really set every wrong right at the material level. We cannot have justice always at the material level. So in that sense, we all need to develop tolerance and focus on transcendence. But different people have different capacities of tolerance. And we can't impose that, you know, I have tolerated, therefore you should tolerate. No, that person's mind may be different, that person's body may be different. It's like, say, physical cold if we consider. Now, some people can walk out even in a terrible cold with just one shirt or something like that. Some people, they will start shivering even with a sweater. Now, if somebody is shivering and they say, I'm feeling cold, if you tell them, don't feel cold. What do you mean, don't feel cold? I'm feeling cold. So, just as each person's body is different, similarly, each person's mind is also different. So, I was in Melbourne and I gave a series of seminars on emotionally healthy spirituality. Emotionally healthy spirituality means that if something, we are very hurt by something, then if somebody else just tolerate it, well, we may not be able to tolerate it. And then we have to have somebody who understands us so that they help us to process our emotions. Now, somebody else may be able to tolerate it. Just like I said, some people's capacity to tolerate cold might be more and some people might be less. So some people may just feel, this is so unfair, I have to counter it. Some people say it's unfair, but I don't want to get involved in it. I'll just tolerate it and move on. So broadly, I say that when there is some unpleasant, unjust situation for us at the material level, there are three broad options of how we deal with it. I call that as tolerate, mitigate, or immigrate. So, tolerate, it's cold, but this is the weather, this is the place where I have my job, my family, so I'll just learn to live with it. Mitigate, I can't tolerate it. Then I'll make sure that I have abundant amount of warm clothes, I have good heating in my room, in my car, everywhere, I mitigate it. But if that doesn't work, then immigrate. I can't stay here, I'll go to some other place which is warmer, I settle over there. So like that, when there is some kind of injustice in our life or in some devotee's life, now tolerance is always a good option, at least the first option. Because if we are not tolerating, then we'll just keep moving from one thing to another. So tolerance is important. But there are some times when tolerance may not be desirable. If we are just too tolerant of injustice, we may subject ourselves to abuse. And people may also become more and more abusive. So in that sense, sometimes we have to mitigate also. And sometimes we may feel that this is too messy a situation, I don't want to get involved in it. So I just walk out, I mitigate, sorry, immigrate then. And Prabhupada also did that at different times. When Prabhupada was in America, staying in the Agarwal's house, at that time they would keep meat in the same fridge where he was keeping his bhoga for offering to Krishna. And when they apologized, Prabhupada said, don't think about it, think nothing about it. Because he had no option at that time. They were the only people hosting, he tolerated it. But later on, when the devotees were even slightly negligent in cooking food for Krishna, Prabhupada mitigated it. He said, you know, Krishna's food, bhoga for Krishna should be highest class. And Prabhupada would grill and train devotees how to cook nicely. And sometimes if there are too many difficulties in a particular situation, Prabhupada established a league of devotees in Jhansi. But then he found there's a whole clique against him to deprive him of that place. And Prabhupada felt Jhansi is too small a place. Anyway, these people are more religious than spiritually committed. He just walked away from there. He immigrated. And we could say Prabhupada even coming from India to America was also a form of immigration. 40 years he tried in India. People are not serious. So he didn't tolerate and say everything is okay. He had his purpose, and to fulfill his purpose, he immigrated. So broadly speaking, we have to see what will serve the purpose of nourishing our heart and taking us towards transcendence. So chanting Hare Krishna is certainly the essential practice. And along with that, the material situation we are in, each one of us to find out how best we can deal with it. whether tolerate it, to mitigate it, or to immigrate from it. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, there's some tendency in political society of the world that we live in, and we are part of that also,
mm-hmm.
to be more obsessed with the justice, material
yeah,
justice.
Yeah, that's true.
And sometimes we think that without this justice, we cannot have a spiritual life. And I think this was the point that
yeah.
Srila Prabhupada was making, that
I agree with you fully.
You must have the spiritual, the chanting of the holy name of Krishna, and then you can have more justice, and you can mitigate, also you can work
yeah.
for justice. But without the chanting of the holy name of Krishna as the central
That's true,
pillar
I agree.
Of one's life, then it will be not very fruitful.
That's true. Because at a material level, Prabhupada would say there is resolution, dissolution, revolution, but no solution. Yeah, so if we just become campaigners for something material alone, that is not going to work. As devotees, we are ultimately campaigners for bhakti. If we make some material cause as our supreme cause, then we'll set ourselves up for frustration. Yeah, I agree fully. Thank you. Yes, Prabhu.
So, really like the example of tolerate, then mitigate, otherwise immigrate. I would add a fourth one, fabricate. I was hearing 2007, Uttama Prabhu was talking about, he gave a lecture on power of mind. How Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that our mind is so powerful, when it's controlled, it's our best friend. When an uncontrolled mind is our worst enemy. He was giving the example that he was just looking down from the Empire State Building, and suddenly in his mind, he heard the voice, jump. He's like, who said that? We immediately said that. So mind, uncontrolled mind can be so dangerous that people can act irrationally, but at the same time, controlled mind can be so well a great friend.
Yeah.
It can help us understand to that, increase our level of tolerance. So that's like fabricating our environment. Ms. Prabhupada came to America and he was in a completely foreign environment. And how he created the Krishna consciousness culture within that environment.
Okay.
And transformed people. That's like, I think of it as like fabricating a cloth. It's like, you can think of it, how he started with thread, from one idea. I mean, when there were students who wanted to understand Sanskrit, and it started with Ishvara Paramaha Krishna Satchidananda. He laid down the foundation from the very beginning. He was fabricating that nice, groundwork.
That's true.
For the expansion of our Krishna consciousness culture. So from the root itself, he was, he was a forward thinker. He was visualizing and he was making it adjust to their situation, not to his situation, but he was welcoming them. He was getting the message across, like you said. He was welcoming everyone, and Krishna is all attractive. Yet it was through his devotees, that attraction was potent.
It's true, beautiful. Yeah, it's interesting, fabricate. The mind can fabricate various things. And I would say fabricate would in any ways be a part of mitigate itself. So, in a sense, what Prabhupada did was, the broad materialistic culture was there, but he mitigated it by creating a spiritual culture within that materialistic culture. Just like outside it's very cold, but we fabricate some electrical structures, machines by which we create a warm environment inside our house. So Prabhupada was very resourceful in that. Thank you. Yes, Prabhupada.
You were talking about, climbing up the mountain to get to the, finding a path up the mountain for a spiritual evolution and ultimate spiritual realization. So what are the symptoms of people who are successfully making that traversing that mountain? What are the signs and symptoms?
Yeah, that's a, what are the signs of somebody who is traversing up the mountain? Yeah, broadly, as I said, that bhakti pareshanubhava viraktiranyatra cha. If somebody is practicing bhakti, they experience God internally, and that experience, so that is something which we cannot externally see. But what we can externally see is, how attached are these people to other things? Viraktiranyatracha. If Prabhupada met George Harrison, the Beatles, so he said, they asked, they were asking, how do you know a guru? Prabhupada said that, just see who is most addicted to Krishna. Who is most addicted to Krishna? Prabhupada used that word specific, addiction, over there. So, to convey that overwhelming attraction to Krishna. So, now in the Bhakti Rasamrut Sindhu, in the Nectar of Devotion, there are certain symptoms which are given of devotion to Krishna. And some are very advanced, like say somebody's tears come from their eyes, their hair stand on their body, and they become overwhelmed with ecstasy. Now these can be in some ways imitated. You know, you just put onion near your eyes, tears will come. And there are people who are sahajiyas who imitate like that. But later on, the Bhakti Samsindhu also describes non-imitable symptoms. This one is avyartha kalatvam, that the such person doesn't waste any time at all. All their time they are using for serving Krishna. And nama gane sadaruchi, always eager to chant the names of Krishna and to glorify Krishna. And then the utkanta, they have the eagerness to behold the forms of Krishna, to go to the holy places of Krishna. Then they also have, so like that, many broad characteristics are described which are behavioral characteristics. So where the person is detached from bodily drives, bodily desires, the person is very eager for associating with devotees. That person is, so we can look at the life of a person and see what they are most eager for. And based on that, we can know, okay, they are eager for this. That means that's where the heart is. So if they are eager to hear about Krishna, that's one way of looking at it. Eager to, not just Krishna, it can be God in any tradition. So if people are eager to glorify about God, eager to serve Him, that is one way we can understand. Another way we can see is, it's not just love for God. Love for God also means love for other living beings. That's why many of the characteristics, titikshava, karunika, suruda, sarvadehinam, ajata, shatrava, shanta, sadhava, sadhubhushanaha. The Bhagavatam describes the characteristics of sadhus. It says sadhubhushanaha. These are ornaments of the sages. The sages don't wear makeup and other ornaments like that, but their ornaments are their virtues, their qualities. It's interesting, these qualities, titikshava is tolerance, karunika is compassion, surudha sarvabdehinam, they're compassionate to all living beings. Titikshava, surudha sarvabdehinam, ajata chatrava shanta. They have no enemies. They don't consider anyone to be their enemy. Others may consider them their enemies, but they don't consider anyone their enemy. And shantaha, they're peaceful. Now these are you could say almost secular characteristics, or they are non-sectarian characteristics. That these are characteristics of how the person behaves with others. So that means we could look at how they are eager for God and how they are in dealing with others. And by that characteristics we can understand that how high up they are on that mountain of going towards spiritual consciousness. Thank you.
Is it correct to think that as you asked for these symptoms, I mean, from Gita, we have so many references of divine qualities and that, and chapter 12 also, Krishna has repeatedly said that person is most dear to me. All these characteristics become a Vaishnava quality.
Yes, definitely.
Person will develop all those as
well. That's true, yes, definitely. Thank you. That is signaling to us we should stop now. No, that's fine. The gods are intervening through technology now. Yes, so till what time should we go on, Prabhu?
Yoga teacher is probably a student, not a session.
Sorry?
Yoga is a teacher's yoga, right?
Okay. So, thank you.
Can we go for 5 more minutes of questions?
Yes, yes, please.
I just want to mention that the thing that you just said seems very central to today's theme, that love of God means love of other living entities also. And that the defining characteristic of advancement in spiritual life, there are many, but one of them is this: that someone who is at the beginning of spiritual life, they love God, but they don't love others. You know, they want to criticize others. But someone who becomes advanced in spiritual life, they see everyone as God's beloved servant, and they want to honor and work for the welfare of others. And then they become Suridham Sarvabhutanam, like that. They become the best friend to everyone, and they don't consider anyone as their enemy. And then when someone looks at others like that, then they actually become more dear to Krishna. And their ability to have a loving relationship with Krishna then blossoms for
them. Mm. Yes, true, very true. Now Prabhupada talks about how the Kanishta Adhikari, Madhyam Adhikari and Uttam Adhikari, the three levels. Kanishta Adhikari sees God only in the deity. As long as I go and pray and worship God, then I am a devotee. But the same people, as soon as they come out of their temple, they may just speak abusive words, speak obscene words, behave in very terrible ways. So sometimes even religious people may do like that. We may become very judgmental towards others, condemning others. I was in Texas and I saw on a car bumper quote. He says that, "Oh God, please save me from your preachers." So sometimes some preachers may think I am being compassionate, but they see others not as souls with their own free will who had to be inspired to serve Krishna. Sometimes some preachers see others simply as objects for indoctrination. You know, then you are there just, I have got my philosophy, I downloaded on you and you accept it, and then my program is successful. It becomes like that. So that is not that we may, the activity may be compassionate, but we may do it in a very uncompassionate way. We may do it in a judgmental way. And so even preachers who actually don't see that, it is not that, some preachers think that I am God's blessing in this person's life. And you know, when I give Krishna, this person's life is in darkness and it will go into light. That is one way of looking at it. The other way is that Krishna is already there in this person's heart, and Krishna has a plan for this person. Let me understand how I can play a part in Krishna's plan for this person. Then what will happen is, we will try to understand the person. And then we will try to explain philosophy in a way that connects with them. In the first few months when Prabhupada was in America, if you see the interview of Sally Agarwal, at whose place Prabhupada stayed, it's very interesting. She says, Swamiji was so interested in everything American. He wanted to know how the vacuum cleaner works, how this device works, how that works, where we go and buy things. Now, Prabhupada was not interested in American culture per se. But Prabhupada wanted to know and learn how American people lived, because they were his audience. So he spent time in understanding them. So the Kanishta means, you know, we think that God is there and everyone else either is irrelevant, or their relevance is only I bring God into their lives according to my own conception how it is. But Madhyama means the middle level is where we see that my relationship with God depends not only on how I worship him in the temple, but also depends on how I deal with other people. And then that's why that person is very careful to be kind and considerate to those who are ignorant, to be compassionate, to be friendly to those who are devoted. A very significant marker of a person's spiritual journey is how they see other spiritual people. If somebody thinks I and God, or I and ultimately, that's all that is. But Madhyama learns to value association. So that is, and then of course they keep away from demonic people, but they understand these are anti-devotional. And then ultimately one sees God everywhere, in the temple and in the hearts of everyone. So yeah, how we relate with people is vital, as a both a expression of our level of devotion as well as a way by which we can increase the level of our devotion. And in a sense, Prabhupada was special about that. There many of Prabhupada's god brothers, some of them were, they had spent their whole life living as renunciates, so they had much more time than Prabhupada to study Shastra. Prabhupada had his own business, his own family, so they were in some ways much more erudite. But Prabhupada was much more compassionate. When Prabhupada came to America, he did not see Americans as, oh, these are degraded people. He saw them as souls who have a spark of spiritual interest. And Prabhupada fanned that spark. When he took his first set of disciples back to Vrindavan, a second time he took in a big way, a whole bus full of disciples. So the local local governmental heads of Vrindavan, they are in a celebration to in his honor. He was like a hometown Swami, had made it big in America. So it was very, it was a matter of pride for them. So then some of Prabhupada's god brothers or other Gaudiya Math devotees, leaders, they couldn't digest this. You know, this was just an unknown Swami. We have been Swamis for so long. So in one of the talks, they tried to subtly minimize Prabhupada. And they said, actually, Swamiji was a businessman in the past. So he knew how to deal with different kinds of people, work with different kinds of people. That's how he went to America and he was able to work with these degraded people also. And he's made them into devotees. Now, we have lived Brahminical lives. We always lived pure lives and we deal with pure people. He's trying to subtly put down Prabhupada. But Prabhupada, of course, did not get into any argument with him. But the point was, one's compassion, one's greatness is seen by how one sees small people also. So Prabhupada did not see the hippies as degraded people. He saw that, but that was not his focus. He saw them as they are searching for something spiritual. They have a spiritual spark. And he fanned that spiritual spark. So to see the good even in the bad, that is a sign of a great mind. As Prabhupada would say, Chanakya Pandit says that you can look for gold even in garbage. So Prabhupada had that capacity. And that's how he not only saw the good in the bad, but he manifested that, he fanned that good, so that that good not only overcame the bad, but that good transformed into the great. And that's how we have so many exalted followers of Srila Prabhupada now, who have graced the world and enriched it with Krishna Bhakti. So, thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Jai Gaur Premanande.
Chaitanya Charan Prabhu ki.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.